Good afternoon. You know, the other day, actually, I was flying from Taiwan. Have you been to Taiwan, any of you, before? Beautiful place. I call it the Italy of Asia. In many ways, the best food in the world, and so on, so on. No, but before that, I was sitting home at my good friend and lawyer in his home in Copenhagen, and I was chatting about that I have to go here for the second year in a row and speak to you guys about, you know, my point of space. And he's a fortunate man. He has 5 children, very productive, 2 wives. No, not at the same time, obviously, right? Denmark is not that kind of place yet. But we're sitting there, and the small 2 daughters were sitting there and next to us, and one of them was listening, you know, big ears, and she was like, "Daddy, are you going to space?" And I was like taking the word and saying, "Yes, your daddy and I are going to go to space next week." And then she was like, "No, Daddy, don't go to space, it's dangerous," like this. And you know, I thought, okay, well, it's not that dangerous at all. It was like it was more like a expression of that what she thought it was. Because where I come from, when I was a kid, I basically had a lot of energy, you know, based on what I loved doing most. And if you can see on the visual, maybe if you can put the visual on the screen from my video read, yes, it should come there. Here we have it. This is my home where I grew up, ladies and gentlemen. This is a Danish trailer park. It's a hippie camp. And I was living there with my parents and my little brother and 2 dogs, 5 cats and 1 horse. The horse was not inside the house, obviously. It was outside most of the time. And most children have, you know, these posters on the walls. You know, girls have, you know, boys on the walls, and boys has girls on the walls, or maybe cars, because it's more interesting when you're younger. But I had neither of these things. I, of course, had this very classic space shuttle poster, you know, in my bunk bed. And every time I woke up at night, I was like feeling, oh, it's cold outside. I look at the spaceship, I'm like, ah, okay, it's nice again. So you draw inspiration from different things. So when, you know, my friend's daughter was terrified about space, I was like, you know, I don't understand why. But when you come into understanding what influence the time sends on you as a child, it is a very powerful thing. Because as a designer, I've been influenced very much by space. And everything I've done my whole life, and my company is doing today as well, is actually something that has inspiration from space, inspiration from the space age for cool shapes, from something that is organic, something that is human in a way, something that can fly. Obviously, you say that most things you can make fly if the engine is big enough, but you guys know everything about that. But to my point of view, it is very important that when we design stuff and it has a soft element as this interior in Beijing, you know, this is the pot you're sitting inside and eating, or this 12 metric ton onyx stone table made out of one piece, 10 meter long. Again, if you put a big engine on this one, it can fly as well, I'm pretty sure. But you can see it has organic shapes, all of it, and this is really what I like doing as a designer, to industrial design and even to our architecture, to the buildings. We use the same kind of idea about, you know, it has to be soft, it has to be something that is non-sharp. You shouldn't cut yourself on it, right? When it comes to my first commercial project, and those of you who were here last year, I talked about it as well, my first nightclub in Copenhagen called NASA, right? I didn't show you actually that the logo even, you know, we were very smart. I wanted to use the NASA logo, but I thought it might be a little bit, you know, on the naughty side. So I just created another one that draw inspiration from the original worm logo of NASA as well. Even then, when we did birthday, this is like the 3-year birthday for the club, we also kind of use the same kind of soft language. So you can see what space does to children. And to me, it's been embedded in my body, and it still is today. And that's why I think it is a very interesting time we are in right now. Actually, last year when I came here, I attended a press conference outside the day before, and it was very, very interesting, and it was, you know, the brightest people sitting around the table. And there was one, you know, I think, local taxpayer standing up and, you know, in a questionnaire and saying, "Can you guys tell me why we're going to space? I don't understand." Something like that, he said, right? And I was like, oh, well, that's quite interesting. That's a difficult question to answer. And one gentleman from the panel, very bright guy, stand up, and he said, "The reason why we're going to space is..." I'm not speaking Danish, I'm just telling you what I heard. "Rocket science." And I was like, okay. to my knowledge, I didn't understand. And I thought I knew quite a lot about space, but I don't. I'm actually a total blank. I know of, you know, the shuttles and the rockets and all that cool stuff and the t-shirts with NASA on, but the rest I don't understand. And if I don't understand it, why should other people understand it? And that's why we're having this conversation about domestication, because I was very wrong, because I thought I understood, but I didn't. But maybe there is a little bit of reflection to do on this one, because maybe there's also the point of what you guys are speaking of is total nonsense. Rocket, scramjet, you know, if you want people to include them, you can't speak nonsense. You know, if I start speaking Danish, there's only one guy who will understand here. Nu taler jeg dansk. I dag, der skal vi have rødgrød med fløde, and so on. You don't understand the word, right? So it's kind of the same, you know, rhythms in what we're doing. We need to be really sure about what is the right words to put on it. Now, when I was a kid, again, I really, really, really believed that in 2001, I would be going to check in at the Hilton. I know I love this movie, but it is just, you know, for a designer, the most iconic movie of them all, because it really shows situations that could be realistic, right? But reality is, this was a total different thing. At that time, it was not about, you know, making a beautiful movie. In the space race, as you had it, it was about actually fighting the communists, right? Russia and all that. But it's not really about the communists anymore. You know, there's none of them, really. I mean, look at it. In reality, everybody is capitalists. So I would say, even from coming from Denmark, we might be one of the best communistic countries in the world because we understand capitalism. And the world has changed a lot. It's not about, you know, a race who has the biggest rocket anymore. Well, at least not from the government side, maybe from the private individuals to have the biggest rocket to go to Mars or someone. That's another thing. But really, this is about our future. And this is what you need to communicate much, 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 much better than you have ever done before. And let's realize it. You guys have given Hollywood the power of communication for way too long. I mean, way too long. There's like some kind of science fiction novelist, like, yeah, and then they're going to space, and then this rocket is coming in, and this robot's going like this. I mean, it's happening. You give them the power. You shouldn't. You need to take the power, and you need to communicate. I mean, let me just show you one little thing. And also, my point of this is that really it's time for a breakup with Hollywood. I mean, you've been girlfriends and boyfriends or whatever it is you are for way too long. You can't give them the power of communication. And one movie that really gave me that last punch was Gravity, because I was watching this, you know, movie in a 3D theater, and I was actually, you know, kind of feeling seasick after like spinning around. And with all respect to Apollo 13, I know real things has happened, but this way of doing fiction, especially with an actress doing this one, I'm just going to show you a little bit of snippet of this movie, because right here, I mean, some of you must have thought about, what about a sea monster coming up and eating her, like this, or a shark or something, just getting her life done. Because in many ways, it's so simplified and dramatic, like, ugh. And to me, it's just too much. And this is what small children is watching and thinking about space. And if we don't get this picture out of people's minds, space will forever be dangerous. Something that can kill you, something that can take you down. And it really shouldn't be, right? But mind you, space is still mystical, and this is also the beautiful thing about it. And if I ask any of you, why did you start working in this industry? All of you would say, it's because it was mystical. There was something about it. There's something about it. If I say, you know, I'm working in the space industry, it's like, woo, right? Am I right? Yeah. I'm pretty sure about this. Okay. So if you ever want to move forward in domesticating space, demystify it. It simply needs to be demystified. Otherwise, it's going to be like this forever. And the young generation, they need to see something new. And mind you also, the only way you can demystify it is if everybody is agreeing this. You know, the private sector as well as the government sector. And this is only through a collective mindset you can actually get this thing flying, for real. But when it comes to brands, you are Americans, most of you at least, and Americans are the masters of the brands. And I think one of the strongest brands in the world, I mean, if you ask a 3-year-old or a 95-year-old, they will all say NASA, right? Like, wow, this is cool. When I was, you know, I'm 43, when I was young, I was totally dazzled about it. I was like, wow, the greatest thing in the world. I mean, even if you take from the Worm logo to the Meatball logo, it is very, very, very cool. It's like really cool. I know it's an internal term about the logos, but and there's also been a little bit of fights between different groups in NASA, is that right? About the logos. But nevertheless, it is super cool. While we from Europe, I mean, we have some pretty strong brands as well, like Ferrari, you know, sports cars, stuff like that. But yet in the space industry, you know, when I saw this logo first time, I thought it's a local power supply company, or maybe someone who sells fingerprint machines. I mean, why can't we do as the Americans does? But it's very clear. We are Europeans, we have the French, we like the logo to be in this way, and the British like, oh, it's bloody well, have a cup of tea, and you know, all these people in the Danish talking about red porridge with cream and so on and so on, so we never actually get to do a proper logo and do communication. But in the future, there's no doubt about it, and I just show a couple of logos now, because there's many powerful new companies who are doing this. And these will be the future NASAs. And the question is, which one of them has the strongest message and the strongest power to actually go out and pull and reclaim space? And this is a very important point in the future of your industry. We simply need to domesticate. We all agree, right? Domestication. I said it last year as well, this year again. Domesticate means space industry is a wolf. You do like this, come on here, wolfie, and it runs to you and it bites you and you either it kills you or you die of rabies, like after a couple of weeks, right? So it needs to be a pet, something you can have, you know, sit in your sofa and throw a stick and it will run for it, right? So that's really the important part of that. Then communicate, because you can't wait 3 years between each communication. Now we have a new rocket that's going to go to space. Yeah, everybody's clapping in their hands. And then 3 years of silence. It doesn't work that way. You need to communicate every day. Think about the young generation of kids. You know, everything is going through this glass telephone that somebody from a fruit company in Cupertino made for them. And you know, if everything goes through that thing, you probably also have to communicate through that in a much more powerful way to be able to get them. That's a very powerful thing. Then you need to rebrand space as well. Then you need to rebrand your companies to not only attract engineers, but you need to also attract people who are creative, people who are dreaming about space and can actually challenge the engineers in a positive way. Because, I mean, honestly speaking, I'm sometimes terrified just looking at you guys because there's so much brain power sitting in one room, knowing about space and knowing about technology. But yet, the communication terms is a very, 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 you know, difficult thing. So actually, reclaim space might be the right thing to do. Reclaim what you have been working for your whole life and actually take it back. In all the different companies sitting here, private as well as government, to take it where you belong it to, right? And it's because of one important thing, and that's the future of humanity. That's why we do it. Also said, in the future,
hello.
I would like to see my kids
hiya, Squirt.
Going to space without
doing?
Any fear. No, small girls, small boys,
where's
dreaming
mommy?
About it, but actually doing it, not just talking about it,
who's
not being afraid
from
it. Seeing the future vision
please?
As it was seen in 1967. I think that's a very strong point. What can I do for you, apart from having a nice chat after this conversation? Well, I can help you maybe schedule the future of communication and design, because you have been off schedule for so many years. And thinking about all the, you know, program directors from NASA and guys sitting here who are very, very serious people, just thinking about the shuttle is not going on time. You need to be back on schedule. Schedule is very, very important for the communication. And then, obviously, what I can do is I can help you to make space sexy again. Are you with me? Thank you very much.
Johannes.
Yes. Yes, we can have a chat as long as not a locker room chat.
Well,
Of course not.
Because we know that's not going to go the
we
right way.
We don't want to go there. No. Johannes, yes. This is a question that I've been working with for 40 years. Many of the people in the room have been trying to excite the public and make space interesting again. What is your suggestion? What are you really suggesting?
Well, what I'm saying is that to reclaim it. I mean, it's like right now space. Why don't you come out here? It's like you have a blue dot to stand on. Uh-huh. It's much better, isn't it? To reclaim it, to take it back, because right now it's kind of floating around in space. And I mean, seriously, space is by far the coolest thing on Earth, right? Can we agree that? I mean, there's nothing more cool than space. But if nobody really claims it and say, here we have it, then what do you do? I mean, NASA did it for sure.
So is space really the coolest thing on Earth? My grandchildren think Pokemon is. So
yeah,
how
but
do
that's
we
the problem.
Compete with that?
You put space into the Pokemon. And in the future, the Pokemon would be on the moon, for instance, so you have to go up there. Let me tell you a story about that, actually. Because a couple of months ago, we did with my company in Copenhagen, a sailing trip, out in a beautiful harbor, if you go to Copenhagen ever. And there's a lot of wind turbines, out in the sea, very big ones. And we're sailing out there, and we're going, towards them, and then we diverted. And all the girls no, we have to go out there. Why? There's a very, very rare Pokemon out there. On a wind turbine in the middle of the ocean. It's like, and this is really, understandably, is a new generation of people, and they don't look, on a newsletter or on a website. It is information has to be right in the face.
So given that short attention span, how do we maintain the attention for a long period of time? You just said yourself, it takes a while to make these rockets fly.
Yeah, it does. I think there's many ways to do it. First of all, when I was a kid, everything about space was just, superior cool. I might not actually pay much attention to if there was a rocket going up or down, but there was a poster, there was a t-shirt, there was a cap, there was all these things before a digital age coming out. Now everything is much faster, and you need to communicate every day. It's not about, once a week, we have to send out our social media. No, every day. You have to have young people communicating. In my company, which is a very small company, we have a 15-year-old do social media. Why? Because he is so much more snappy than I am and anyone else. Because it's we have to run Snapchat and snap what? I don't even know how to use it. But realizing that you need to simply up the game.
Can
it's
we
important.
Keep a 15-year-old on target without saying something that'll offend somebody?
Well, you might need to put a filter on. Oh. Just a small one. But I really think so. I really think you can actually use the youth in a much more proactive way than it is done today.
Twitter seems to be the mode of operation of the young people today. So how do we make
gone.
Sure that we're all trending?
Yeah, but the Twitter is already the past.
See, so old.
Yeah, I mean, face it, Facebook is for 45-year-olds. We're posting, and classroom pictures like that. Twitter is for 55 years old or older, or just people who want to put a lot of words online. Blah, 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 blah. I have an opinion, right? Or the president candidates as well. They can shout and scream at each other, do locker room jokes. reality is that the Snapchats and, many new things that I don't even understand or know how to spell is the way to communicate. And it's done by one picture and then it's gone. And you think about why do that. But there is something very relieving about it. You can just bring on doing it. And this is what the space industry has to do as well. You have to communicate nonstop.
So if we get the teenagers on board, how do we get the congressmen on board? Because that's where the money comes from.
That's another story. Well, I don't think it's the locker room jokes again. I think that has to be kept totally away from that. I think it's a question of actually making space desirable. Because right now, there's a lot of private individuals, private companies with different interests in how to, actually go to space and why they want to go to space. But if you can grab their attention and you can make one thing where the branding is a collective mind, then the congressman can only agree that this is a very important thing for humanity.
I think you'd be doing great if you can get the congressman to agree on anything.
Oh, excellent.
Yes.
Put me in front of them. I will try my best. Okay. With Danish accent.
With a Danish accent.
Hi, I'm from Denmark. I would like to talk to you, congressman, about something. That's a typical Danish accent. So it might not work, but I think there is relevance is actually, bringing it in a different perspective.
Very good.
Wonderful, gentlemen. Thank you so much for your insights and that different perspective, and for interjecting as well. Might I say you're pretty good at it, Mr. Wayne Hale?
Yeah, you are pretty good.
Have
you done that before?
Yes.
Okay.
You know, tomorrow there's an opening for Master Moderator. What do you think?
I think it'd be great.
Game on. All right.
He's going to do it tomorrow.
Master do that tomorrow.
Moderator, Wayne Hale, Johannes Thor.
Thank you,
thanks so much for your insights.
Thank you very much.